Hemos trabajado así los platos y claro, mis cosas. So, that looks, así que fue con mi empresa de Redcliffe, and we hope we have a very, very fruitful discussion this morning. I will now ask that we introduce ourselves, because it's good to know each other. I'll start by myself. Kwame Yatin is my name. I'm the permanent secretary of this ministry.
It has said outreach officer, strategic communication.
Alpha Saibu Bangura, the Western Region Coordinator, Strategic Communications Unit.
I'm now the new voice.
Juliana Adam Avandi, Outreach Officer, Strategic Communications Unit, MIC.
Samo Bayon, Senior Accountant, Ministry of Information.
Duran Pestoma, Head of Town Police, Ministry of
Information. Nene.
Ashuta Jerry Bari, Assistant Accountant, MIC.
So that's the alias. Legal B.
Yes.
Yes, sir. With that introduction, I will now invite. I have the honor to invite the chairman to tell us why we're here. What is it?
Thank you, Honorable Secretary, and the Commission is grateful for allowing us to stand with you. So we give you a very short notice, and magnanimous enough to have us today. I mean, the purpose of our coming here is to update the Ministry on the activities of the Commission, principally on our legal reforms. And before we go to that, I want first of all to tell you what the Commission is. We are a creation of Section 34 of the Constitution, the 1991 Constitution, and Section 35 mandates, 35(6) mandates Parliament to enact a law that will define our scope of operations. And Parliament, in portions of that subsection, they passed the Political Parties Act in 2002, number 3 of 2002. That is the act that set us up. And, basically, we are here to update the Ministry on the legal reforms. Following the 2018 elections, we had election observer missions. And after the elections, part of their reports, they made certain recommendations that they think, if implemented, will enhance the capacity of all EMBs, that is election management bodies, and will also lead to the conduct of a more credible, fairer elections. And in keeping with those recommendations, the task force was set. And the task force looked into all of the recommendations. There were 111 of them. The task force admitted 103 that we are now trying to implement. Some of them are legal in nature, the others are administrative. For those that relate to us are that the instrument that set us up, that is the Political Parties Act of 2002, has to be reviewed and amended so that it will foster the mandate of the Commission. So basically, that is what we have been doing. We have been engaging in compliance with those recommendations to ensure that the Act, the PPRC Act, is reviewed. And the revision of that Act will go a bit too far, and we wanted the Ministry to know how far we have gone. Basically, the purpose of that revision is to enhance the capacity of the PPRC and to also ensure that we have the requisite powers to enforce our mandate. Our mandate basically is to register political parties and to also supervise and monitor their conduct. Everything political parties do in this country is our responsibility to monitor their activities and supervise them. So we are more or less an oversight body for all registered political parties. We have 17 of them, and so far the relationship may not be as cozy as we want it, but I think we have a working relationship with all of them. So basically, that is our mandate. Now, if you look at the Political Parties Act of 2002, not enough powers are given to the PPRC so that they will be able to execute our mandate. We are an oversight body and a regulatory body with absolutely no regulatory powers. The powers that we have now are merely supervisory. So this is why sometimes people look at the PPRC as ineffectual. Some are describing us as a toothless bulldog, because the acts that set us up did not give us the necessary powers to ensure that we regulate the political parties and man their affairs. So for now, the only regulatory power we have is to be registered. And to us, that is extreme. You cannot imagine the registering SLPB or APC, the security implications involved in that. So basically, or effectively, we do not have regulatory powers at all, because the only regulatory power we have is very extreme. So you will see that political parties, they get away with a lot of things. And at the end of the day, the commission is looked at as incompetence. We have not been able to carry out our mandate and that kind of thing. So this was why, when the observers that came to observe the elections in 2018, they saw those gaps, they decided to make recommendations that in order to make the commission more effectual, the instrument that set them up, that is the Political Parties Act, needs to be amended and replaced. Otherwise, they will not be able to perform their function very well. So this is why we are now here to tell you how far we've gone with those reforms. Basically, I'll go to the nature of the reforms we are contemplating. In the first place, we want a change of name. For now, we are called the Political Parties Reputation Commission. To us, the name attempts to define what we do. And any name that attempts to tell the public what we do, in our view, is restrictive. For instance, the current name now is just Political Parties Reputation Commission. And we normally register parties, we mediate parties, we also supervise and that kind of thing. So we thought that the name is restrictive. And no matter how long the name is, it cannot capture our mandate. It cannot actually tell the person that we just look at the act and knows what we do. So we decided to recommend that instead of Political Parties Reputation Commission, we will be called Political Parties Commission. If somebody wants to know what we do, we go into our act and we know our mandate. I mean, we are borrowing this from other commissions like NASPOP. You don't know what NASPOP does until you go into the act. So we think if the name attempts to define us, it will be very, very restrictive. Then if you look at the composition of the commission at the moment, we are four in number. I, the chairman, then I have a commissioner representing Labour Congress, a commissioner representing the Bar Association, and a NEC chair is an ex-official member of my own commission, ECP as well. So four of us are the commissioners. So in the first place, we want an odd number commission for voting purposes and for purposes of quorum. So we are recommending that the new act, those who are going to draft the new act, contemplates the possibility of adding one more statutory commissioner, because I'm the only statutory commissioner and the rest are representing their own organizations. So one of the recommendations is to ensure that we put in one more commissioner so that we have a five-member commission. We have some odd number commission. And we also want to look at our mandate. As I was saying, the mandate is very limited as it is now. For instance, in terms of mediation, where there is an intra-party dispute amongst the leadership of a political party, we cannot go in as of right, the act that we have now. We cannot go in as of right. We have to be moved by either the party itself or the very members of the leadership that is in dispute. So it means even those who come to us with complaints, they are very much restricted. The ordinary membership cannot come to us with a complaint. I'll set an example when the NRM went to us in respect of the leadership dispute in the APC. I mean, the APC came in and objected that all of the members of the NRM, none of them is a member of the National Executive. And by Section 6.2e, you have to be a member of the disputed leadership of the party to come to the PPRC. And the PPRC cannot go in as of right to mediate. So if you see some of this leadership dispute among political parties wrangling, and we sit there as an oversight body, we cannot come in to intervene and have those disputes resolved. It's because our mandate by the AFPA set also is very limited in that respect. So we think that the new act should also empower the PPRC to go in as of right without being moved by anybody to mediate between the leadership of political parties that are in dispute. Then we also think that the category of persons that should come to us with complaints should not only be limited to the leadership that is quarreling among themselves, because these are the people who are fighting. They definitely cannot come to us to complain. So we want that right to be extended also to the ordinary membership of the parties. For instance, if your party is disputing, the leadership is disputing, definitely the membership will be affected, because the ordinary membership will want to see a cohesive leadership that will strengthen their political party, the chances of an electoral success. But if the leadership is fighting itself all over, then the true owners of the party, who are the ordinary members, because these leaders are just given the privilege of managing the affairs of the political party, they are not the owners of those parties. This is what I always emphasize to them. You have a responsibility to the actual owners of that political party, that is the ordinary members. They own the party. Without them, there is no political party. You make noise because you have a political base. If you don't have a political base, you are nothing. So we want the new act to also contemplate the possibility of allowing ordinary members to come to the PPRC and ask us to intervene in the event of disputes amongst the leadership of political parties. That's another limb of the amendment we are contemplating. Then we come to the registration of political parties. For now, the registration fee is 2,500,000. We think that is funny. A political party is supposed to be a very serious affair. And we've checked around, we've done our background check for the sub-region. Even in the small Gambia, to register a political party is the equivalent of $40,000 in Dallas. And you come here to register a political party is $250 if you want, if you like. Which is really, really very laughable. So we are of the view that we need to also revisit that particular part of the act so that we'll make the registration fee much more, not impossible. We will not want to use money to exclude people from political participation, but we want to make it look a little bit serious. Yes, so that you will not have any jack and jill coming to register political parties because you only need to part with 2,500,000. We want people to come in who are serious and who can attest that at least they have the wherewithal. At the end of the day, this is why most of these political parties don't function, because people who register them, they do not even have the means to carry them on. So after elections, they are quiet. We want to change that narrative. And we are also thinking of the possibility of not only increasing the registration fee. For now, what we have in mind is 100 million euros. I mean, that is subject to parliament, parliamentary approval. That is what we are contemplating. Because, as I said, we also do not want to make it impossible for the ordinary people without money to participate in the governance of the state. But at the same time, we want to make it a little bit more serious, the seriousness it deserves for you to register a political party. So we are contemplating that. And it's not only the issue of increasing the registration fee. We are also thinking that political parties ought to renew their registration after every 5 years. This is so because from experience, we note that most political parties are a one-man thing. After elections, Most of them will abandon the parties, they leave the parties in the hands of small, small boys, and they go away. So, I mean, if you need to come, and also that can help us to gauge the compliance rates of political parties in terms of their reporting responsibility and other things they are supposed to do. Because when you come for registration, for re-registration, so to speak, we will look at your conduct for the previous 5 years and see if you are compliant and if you are really comporting yourself in a manner that any political party leader or political party is supposed to comport itself. So we are also recommending that we look at the possibility of having political parties registering after every 5 years so that the commission will have the responsibility of monitoring their conduct. And when you come to register, we'll let you know how you conduct yourself. So that's another area of review that we want. So that then coming to the sanctions. As I earlier on stated, we do not have intermediate powers. We do not have intermediate sanctions to punish default. That is by way of fines. For instance, if you misconduct yourself in your campaign trail, we should have the responsibility to either fine the candidate that is campaigning or the political party that is campaigning. If you misconduct yourself for instance, like hate speeches, we should be able to come in and, as long as we are able to establish that this person is linked to this political party that is written hate in the country, we should be able to have some sanction to impose. Well, as I said, the only sanction we have now is to register. And you cannot ordinarily register a party because of the conduct of one man. You understand? And as I said, the two big ones, if you register any of that one, there are a lot of implications involved. You understand? So these are not really sanctions that we want. So we want some intermediate sanction that will empower us to impose fines for misconduct. For instance, political parties, they have reporting responsibilities. They are supposed to submit to us their audited statements every year, which almost all of them are not doing. Then they are supposed to provide us with a list of their members, executive, from the lowest cadre to the highest cadre. We are supposed to have that, and they are supposed to keep those records in their offices. I can tell you, none of them has done that. And a lot of other reporting obligations, they have campaign expenses. I mean, before you go to an election, you have to let us know what you have in your account. Then after the election, you should come to us to tell us how much you have expended in your campaign. None of them is complying. If after the 2018 elections, I think the only candidate that has given us his campaign expenses is His Excellency the President. None of the other flag bearers is done so. Then the APC as a party and the SLPP as a party, they've done theirs. The rest have not. So these are all infractions that we cannot punish them because we don't have intermediate power. The only power we have is to register them. And when you register, people will skew it to their own advantage. They will begin to talk about political winch horns, they will talk about political intimidation and that kind of thing. Not that we are fearful of those accusations, but we just want to, this is a nascent democracy. We also want to be a little bit pliable and see how much we can push the development of our democracy. So we want those intermediate sanctions to enable us to find people in appropriate fines for misconduct, either by political parties or by the candidate. And where you fail to report, we should also be able to impose sanction rather than going to that extreme thing of the registering you. So all of these are issues we are also contemplating to see if those can be captured in the new act. Then we come to political finance. I mean, we talk about political finance, that is where we need to know how political parties raise their funds, how they expend those funds, and for purposes of transparency. But again, we see that most of the political parties are cash strapped. Some of them cannot really function properly because of economic constraints. So in the new act, we are recommending to the government that the government thinks of subventing political parties, so that every political party would be entitled to some kind of subvention annually. I know, the subvention should be pegged on your political capital, because we are not only going to subvent you when you do not do much in the elections. You did not even get up to a third of the votes. I mean, we subvert you by your political relevance. Because if you give the same money you give to PLP, for instance, to APC, you are not helping the APC. Because the APC is a much more bigger political party, and they have huge responsibility in terms of membership and if they want to restructure. So in that case, we are also recommending that let the government think of subventing political parties, annual subvention, to help build their capacities so that they will be able to function well as political parties and participate effectively in every election. So that's another area that I know will have some tussle, but from initial indications, I don't think the government is averse to that. I cannot make a statement, a definitive statement on behalf of the government, but I'm just saying from initial engagement, the signs are okay. I mean, the signs we are getting in that respect. So that, and this will not only help build the capacity of political parties, it will also help enhance our oversight responsibility. Because as they say, you put your mouth where your money is. So if you know I have something to give you annually, and then you know that you have some responsibility towards him in terms of reporting obligations, you will comply. If you don't comply, I don't give you the money. You understand? So it will not only build the capacity of political party, it will also enhance the oversight responsibility of the commission, because we now have something to hold on to, I mean, in the event of non-compliance. So this is something that we are pushing very seriously. And in terms of structural review, as I said, we have the legal one and also the structural review to help us enhance our capacity in the performance of our mandate. We commissioned the PSRU as a public sector reform unit, I suppose. And we commissioned them to look at our structures as they are now and advise us. So they've just given us a management functional review report, which we have, and we have submitted that one to the Ministry of Finance. I mean, depending on the response we get from the ministry, if we have what they have recommended, this will not only enlarge the commission, or it will give us the necessary expertise that we want. Now we want to have an integrated directory system instead of managers and that kind of thing. And even our registrar, we now intend to change that name to executive secretary in keeping with the modern day trends. So these are all the functional review recommendations that have been done. They have recommended for various offices that we do not have now, and we have sent those to the Minister of Finance, so that when they give us the approval to go ahead and recruit, we will recruit. So basically, this is what we are up to. And as I said, the EU, to some extent, is funding this. And they gave us a consultant that was to review our act, that's the Political Parties Act, and the NEC Act, the Public Relations Act. The consultant did his job, gave us a draft report. We sat as a commission, appraised that report, made our own inputs, and we sent back his draft report to him. He's looked at our contributions, and he's come out with the final report which he has given us. We have also had initial engagement with the Attorney General's Office and Minister of Justice, because he's also very pivotal in this. I mean, we are under the presidency, so if anybody is to get a cabinet conference for us, it will be the Attorney General. That one, yeah. So we have engaged him on that, and if there is going to be any drafting of a bill, it has to be the parliamentary division of his office. So we do not want to go through a very circuitous path in this by going through the law reform, because in our view, what the law reform would have done is what the consultant has done. So now we only need to prepare what we call legislative instructions for the attention of the AG, and that is where we are now. But before we go to the AG, I mean, our sister EMB, that is NEC, they've just done their own validation exercise last week, and we are also intending to do ours. But for the court order that we have now to supervise the elections that are to be conducted by the APC, we are contemplating next week, but anyway, it's not possible, because next week we'll be all around the country with the APC conducting the election to constitute the National Religious Conference. So, after that, we also call a validation meeting of critical stakeholders like political parties, relevant CSO, like NEW and others, so that we also go to wherever we go to sit down and evaluate our proposals for the new act, then come out with some concrete decision. So, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Piers, so far this is what the Commission is doing, and we want the Minister of Information to know how far we've gone with our legal review, and if there are inputs from the end, they will be very much appreciated. Thank you very much for your audience.
Thank you very much, Chairman. Ladies and gentlemen, Chairman has laid it out there for you to digest and also have the opportunity to ask questions if necessary for next suggestions. If I can recap, in terms of the reforms, they want to change their name, Political Parties Commission. Also, they want to increase the composition of the commission, have an odd number, which is the normal thing. Anybody can have an even number in the board because of voting purposes. They also want to increase the registration fee from we had 2.5 million to 100 million, although I want that 100 million to go beyond that. It's got, if you get, you have to get serious. You cannot wake up one morning and sleep on the wrong side of your hand and you say, I want to change the political party. In my life in this country, I've seen jokers wake up in the morning. A friend of mine called me one day, he said he has formed a political party. He wants my support. I told him, let's have a meeting, one-on-one and talk. And he brought the certificate. And that was a joke of a century. And he didn't even get a percent of the votes. That tells you how serious we should be as a country. Then, of course, renewal of registration of political parties every 5 years. That will also respond to the commission. They renew their registration and so that they will review and see whether they are serious or they flag an anti political party or they just want to settle scores with their current parties. Now, the political history of Sierra Leone, most of these parties are offsprings from the current political parties. Because they are disgruntled or they didn't get what they want. So most times they are protest political parties. So after elections they die again. Also sanctions. Yes, the commission should be able to punish people for doing the wrong thing. Then political party financing. All over the world you have to tell the commission of the country how you got your money. Maybe it's bad money, whether it's money laundered. You have to explain. Raised from people's money. Most in the West, people contribute to political parties. Then after that, they give account for how they spend the money, not only to the commission, but even to the people who pay their money to contributions. And also, the structure, you have to review the structure. They just done the structure of the commission. And NFR has been conducted, creating more offices and also making the commission look like an institution. We are not just have commission chairman, commissioners, and the registrar, and also few staff. Have you seen the executive commission? Now we have to have more offices created to perform the functions of the commission. To be a regulator, it's not an easy task. So you have to have all the tools necessary. So these are the reforms they are suggesting. So now the floor is open for you to make suggestions or to ask questions. And then as the government marquees Ministry of Information and Communications, we should be able to propagate their message very well. And in doing so, you must be informed. You yourself must be educated enough to do that. So this is the right time to ask questions and also make suggestions so that when you're reporting, be very accurate and effective. So, Alpha Sidi, as a member of the Democratic Party of America,
thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I didn't know that you guys were not mandated to enforce the laws governing political parties. I was confused with one thing. The Constitution of Sierra Leone, which is supreme law, says that your internal structure, the internal structure of a political party, must be elected by democratic principle. There was this problem with both the APC and the SAPP while I was in the United States. I sent an email to the PPRC, nobody responded, they just ignored it. Because there was a time when people were selected to handle very serious positions in their political parties. So I made reference to the constitution. Nobody responded. So now I understand why I was totally ignored. The second thing, in your reform, don't you think that you should have a provision that says if people contribute any amount of money for campaign, the leadership of the party cannot use that money for anything else? Because in the United States, if you use campaign money for personal use, that is a crime. You can be taken to court. So don't you guys think that you should have something like that?
Okay. Thank you. I'll start with the internal democracies of political parties that you asked about. And this is really permitting all of the political parties that we have in this country. This validation mechanism, somebody went for them. I heard him say, none of you here is in compliance with the internal democracy. I mean, people want to give us the answer. But the commission as it is now, we still can come in. Because at the end of the day, those just want one review. The SLP did their other elections. And some people were dissatisfied with the conduct of those elections. They came to us by way of petition. We look into their matter and we upheld some of those petitions. We cancel whatever was done by the party and we ordered that those elections should be conducted under our supervision, which we did. We did not receive a very complimentary response from the social media, but those are crucible decisions to expect with the office we occupy. It's not an immediate one. So we are bastards, we are insulted, but what is important is we cater for the interests of the ordinary membership of the SLPP. We went there, we ensured that we conducted those elections, and the ordinary members participated and elected the persons they want to man the affairs of their party at that scale. So this internal democracy, yes. In fact, most of them now, some of them, they are the term they were elected for has elapsed, and they are still holding on to offices, starting from the big ones.
Chairman and leader.
Yeah, the big ones. You understand? So, and they have these provisions in their constitution, which we are also going to look at. These provisions that mandate them to call the next meeting and renew their mandate for a number of times. The SLPP has done it severally. And the APC also has done it with their NAC. And I think that is not good enough for internal democracy. Even if you should have that power as an organ of the party to extend the mandate of the executive, I think it should be once. You cannot use that to perpetrate your stay in office as executive members of the party. So the internal democracies of political parties, we are looking at. In terms of contribution, this is where political demand comes in. Why we are happy on this is the fact that we do not want to see the corrupt influence of money coming into play in our politics. The situation where our politicians will mortgage the country even before they win power. And at the end of the day, when they win power, they are going to answer to those who sponsor them. So this is why we want in the new act. Of course, even in the current act, we have those. It's just that they are not compliant. And we sit down, we could not do anything because the act did not provide sanctions for non-compliance. As I said, the sanction they provide is extreme. And it's not something that we really want to readily have recourse to. Not that we are fearful of anything, but we also have a responsibility to maintain the peace. So this is why, in the new act, we want intermediate sanctions to punish those defaults. So that when people, and we need to know where you get your money. As I said, it's difficult. Because multilateral corporations and that kind of thing, even individuals, will fund politicians to win power. And when the politician is able to win those power, then they will answer to them directly. This is the whole essence about political finance, monitoring the source of their revenue. Let us know where that money is coming from. And let us know if this money was a genuine donation because of ideological belief. It should not be a donation that is informed on some other interest should purely be, I mean, on ideological belief, so that you buy the ideology of this political party and you think they should put your money there to enhance their campaign. But you should not come in, I give you money, when you come, you give me all the contracts, that kind of thing. So this is why we are monitoring this.
I was talking about people who put money for campaign purposes and then their monies are taken to something else for private use. What would you do?
Yes, political parties, even the political parties have talked about transparency. They have to be accountable to their membership. You understand? But as I said, the problem with the commission as it is now, we are an oversight body, we are a regulatory body without regulatory powers. This is where we are handicapped. You understand? We are aware of those things. Let us say, for instance, when Goodluck Jonathan was it, gave some money, a lot of uproar came in because some of the leadership of the political parties misdirected those funds for their own personal use. And some of them ended up in court. And this is all not good. Because if the commission is really conferred with the requisite regulatory powers, most of these court actions we are seeing now amongst political parties will not happen.
Okay.
Because we will come in and ensure that we settle those disputes, and we should have the mandate to ensure that whatever decision we take should be binding. Our decisions should have that coercive force for political parties. But because we don't have now those powers now, this is why the courts are inundated. As I said, the APC, we are going to resolve that matter when the NRM went to us. But they went to us and said, the faces that came to you, they don't have mandate to come to you on matters of this nature. Now we said, okay, hands off. You understand? And when they went to court, the leadership started blaming me again. The PPRC has shifted their responsibility. You told me I don't have a mandate. And I looked at the law, I knew what you were saying was correct. You understand? I could not have forced myself to go into the matter when one party has objected that, no, Mr. Commissioner, you don't have a mandate in this because of the people that came to you. If it was the leadership of the party that came to you, you would have had the mandate to mediate. But all of these boys that have come to you, they are not members of the national leadership of the party. So they cannot come to you. It was a different thing in the ADP. The ADP, they came to us, but fortunately, among the complainants, there are people who are executive members. So in that case, we are able to go in and resolve their differences. This is why they are not in court. But if you quote the law, and I'm a lawyer, then I know what you are saying is right. I have to succumb to what you are saying. This was what happened. But now they are coming back to us. So we hope that now that they are coming willingly, we'll have a role to play in resolving that difference.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. For those of us this morning who are absent, when we told staff members that we have a meeting with the PPRC, people are absent. What are we doing with PPRC? I mean, at least we have now seen the relevance of the meeting and the education we have received this morning. And as Kwaleniers, we should really, be eager to know about what institutions are doing. So, Chair, I think these are very, very, timely. Reform that you are undertaking, like you said, as a regulatory institution, things like compliance should really be things that you should be concerned about. So my suggestion in the reform that you have outlined is that also see the possibility how technology could play a role in enhancing your posture as a commission, so that you are very prompt and you have evidence. You know, in the world now, they say data is evidence. So once people come, or once you present a report with evidence, for instance, if they are reporting a requirement that people are not doing, your system should be able to prove that you are not reporting and things like that. And this is where, with the leave of the permanent secretary, I would say that the ministry can also play a role to help you, like for instance, compliance issues, registration. These are all things that you can put digital systems in place to help you. Political financing, you can develop systems where, they can be reporting and then you're able to upload your report and things like that. So as a ministry on the leave of the permanent secretary, I would say that once you have this kind of vision, this is something we can also seek with you and then give you the kind of support you require in setting up systems that will also strengthen your posture in the reform that you are doing. So I'll follow up this with a question, and that is the reform that you have envisioned. Do you think that you are going to accomplish them before the next round of elections right at the corner? Are we expecting to see a new commission, or this is like maybe for the future? Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much, and thank you for the indication of support you've given us. The staff, we have taken note of that. Yeah, your question is very important because we have this ECOWAS protocol that says laws relating to elections cannot be enacted 6 months to elections. This is why we are working around the clock to ensure that we see if we can accomplish all of this within this year. We not only want to work within the 6 months time indicated by the ECOWAS protocol, we even want to do it at least for a year before the election could come. So it all depends on other institutions. Because for instance, now after this validation that I've spoken about, we are going to go to the AG's office. They will have to draft the bill. So we are desirable of achieving these reforms before the next election cycle. But this is not something that is entirely in our own hands. I mean, from the legislative reform, I mean, instructions to take them to cabinet, cabinet ratifies from there to parliament, even to get government printers to gazette your bill, and that kind of thing. So these are all obstacles we are envisaging. But we are determined to ensure that we have it. We have this law before the next election.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I just want to know if your reform encourages political parties to include gender balance in the members.
Yes, thank you very much. Yes,
gender
mainstreaming, and especially when we have the gender empowerment bill, we have just spoken to the Minister of Gender to meet with political parties on that day. And when the Honorable Chief Minister was making his presentation during the next validation, he made it very clear to all of us here that whatever reforms we are doing, we should have in mind the gender bill, the 30% quota for both elective and appointive offices. And we are also very pivotal as far as that gender bill is concerned in terms of, well, they prefer to call it reserve seats rather than free seats for women. And we and NEC will have to sit down and determine which of the seats that will be reserved, because I had an issue for appointive positions. Yes, that is within the ambit of government. They can do that. They will be appointments. Gender ministry, yes, is achievable. Access to finance for women, yes, is achievable. Seems that people were talking about collateral. People were talking about collateral, particularly when they say women do not own property, particularly so in the provinces. Most of the title rates, if collaterals are required, are in the names of men. So that could be another challenge. But it is also achievable. My issue was, how will you do it to achieve the 30% quota? And, well, that's what the minister explained to me in a way that I also went to this school, because when you have, it's not a safe seat, it's a reserve seat. What does that mean here? You go to a district, you take a particular constituency, and you say this particular term, all political parties must fill in female candidates for this constituency.
Oh, okay.
So in any event, a woman will win. Then you go to another district, you take a seat there, say this seat is exclusively for women. So all political parties will be compared to fill in women.
Yes.
So that is something that NEC and PPRC will sit together with the political parties. Then we determine which of those seats. And the seats, the reserve seats, are going to be rotational, because you don't want to deprive the men in a particular constituency forever. So when that is why again the issue coming, because they are saying the reserve seat is for a term, and the issue is when you are in parliament, you do a term, your pension is not very appreciable. But if you do two terms, it's a very appreciable pension. And 5 years, I don't think is enough for a woman to learn the parliamentary procedure. 5 years will be a learning period. So those reserve seats, we are also saying, make it for a two-term. Then after that, we move to another. And look, every day there will be problems. Because let's not say if you move to the other constituency and the main candidate is there, the main MP, who is just done his first term, he wants to go for a second term. That will bring us problems. But we are going to try. I mean, it's a step in the right direction. We'll move it and see what we can do. Because sometimes people have to sacrifice for the good of the country. So if it is you that fall victims, the male MP, who just done his term, we bear it up.
Two more questions. You have to observe code regulations.
Thank you very much. I want us to go quickly to the renewal of the registration of political parties. You said you have intention to have the registration fee being around 100 million, which I would want to queue up, join the line with the permanent secretary to see how we can get that a little bit bigger. But what you've not mentioned is that on the renewal, after the 5 years elapses, will it trigger another payment of the same sum, or will there be a minimal renewal fee? We want to get that clear. Secondly, you said there are certain compliance measures that you will put under test to confirm as to whether the political party will reach the threshold for renewal. Don't you think that some political parties or ruling government will, with time, use that as a tool to sort of disqualify a political party that may sound as a threat to them? I'll give you a typical reference now. There were some big sounding voices that were very clear that if I do not get this election result in my favor, I will make this country very ungovernable. And we have seen so many incidences of politically triggered violences. The catching aspect of it now is that somebody will want to dissociate those incidences with your political party. Which mechanism will you put in place to confirm as to whether somebody that triggers violence but do not carry political party card, how will you connect that person with the political party that you want to put under test in terms of compliance level? Thank you very much.
Yeah, okay, thank you. We start with the renewal. Yes, that was an oversight. We definitely will not ask you to pay what you paid to register initially. I mean, when it comes to renewal, we are thinking maybe one third of the registration fee will be paid at renewal. But these are all proposals. We're going to meet our constituents, who are the political parties, then they will make their own inputs. I know it's not going to be easy, but fortunately, at this time, all of us are trying to speak to the recommendations of the UN. So they are also, as political parties, they are dealing with their donor partners and that kind of development partners. So at least this creates an opportunity for those development partners and donor partners to see how genuine some of these political parties are. If they are just parochially thinking of their partisan interests or they have a national agenda, you know, it will accord them the opportunity to weigh down on their genuineness. Then coming to the issue of the possibility of abusing, this is where the problem is normally. Because as an oversight body, particularly parties in opposition, they are often apprehensive of giving too much powers to the oversight body. Because they are often saying that there is every likelihood that the ruling party can use that to stifle them. But again, those are fears. In any event, somebody will sit in my seat. I mean, so in any event, you'll have to have trust and confidence in the person who sits on that seat at the moment. Because yes, these are genuine fears. They are justifiable apprehensions from political parties. But there is nothing we can do about it. Because no matter what I say now, it's self-serving. No matter what undertaking I will give to you now, that don't worry, I mean, I will be fair, that's self-serving. There is nothing that is guaranteed. But they say, the taste of the pudding is it limiting? Mm-hmm. You understand? So you have to try whosoever is there. But you cannot also say, because of those fears, then the oversight body should be left powerless. You have to be regulated. And somebody said it in the validation process. If you are compliant, you don't need to be afraid of any oversight authority by the regulatory body. As long as you are compliant. Because they will only come after you when you are not compliant. And sometimes people do not comply with the law. And when you ask them to, they cry foul. That is common. You understand? But those are genuine fears. But the most we can say about those fears is that trust in the process and trust in the occupants of those seats. But I don't think any political party would want to, particularly those in opposition, would buy in my giving them confidence and don't worry. It's possible I may not be there tomorrow. But let us strengthen the mandate of the oversight body so that they will be able to perform their functions effectively. Now, as regards the issue that when you say somebody is not registered but is making inflammatory statements, I mean, definitely from the content of the message, I think you should be able to deduce which of the parties he has sympathies for. I mean, you can disclaim your membership of a particular party that you are affiliated with, but from the content of the messages you send there, out there, somebody will be able to know which of the parties are you favoring. So I think we can use that method if I know that what is the content of your messages. But this issue of hate speech is something that is very, very important. Hate speech, insulting languages, some of us, Umamade Wojan died for so long, have been put on the platter for 2 weeks. Then it cost them. But what is important is, me by blessing to Mama, and I know, see, what I'm being insulted for is not something that I did that is wrong. You understand? So, you don't care about that. You understand? But this has to stop. Even yesterday in my meeting with the APC, Honorable Kemosi said, hat on that one. That we are all Africans. You cannot insult my mother. My mother. You understand? And you expect me, at the end of the day, you come and talk to me to your line. I will not do it, my mama. You understand? So even if I do not react, you know, that kind of thing, but at least I don't think I'll take that kind of thing as an African. You understand? Let us just look at our customs and traditions. You know, of course, my mama. You understand? So these are all things that are necessary that we do something to regulate. And one thing I also noted is that most of the political parties, they have all distanced themselves from those people who are perpetrating this kind of thing. But one thing they have not done is to come out and condemn those acts. Yeah, I see, or rather, I saw the SLPP did that once when somebody threatened some APC people. Yeah, the party came out with a statement and dissociated themselves and condemned the act. But you do not only dissociate yourself from gross conduct, you also have to come out as a political party and condemn. If they do that, those people who are practicing those kind of misconduct, I think they will know that if not somebody they go talk to in a corner and tell you to do this, then that person can publicly and say, what should you do in a bad thing? Me, I'm not there with you. You will have a rethink. So these are all the issues.
Last question.
I think there's no more. I want to say thank you, Mr. Chairman. This, I use the words of administration, very progressive reforms, which as a ministry we are very much supportive of. And rest assured, as my director said, we're going to support you achieve this. And also, we make publicity out of it so that the public will be educated and so that we are aware that these reforms are coming and also have their input. Thank you very much. And have a pleasure.
Thank you.